Hi, everyone. Welcome to our lunch hour, Philanthropy Think in Defense of Philanthropy. We have the privilege and the honor of welcoming our friend and colleague, Beth Breeze, who is the director of the Center of Philanthropy at the University of Kent. She began her career working for a youth homeless charity and spent a decade working in fundraising research and charity management. Over the past 15 years, she has conducted numerous research studies on philanthropy, including interviews with over 100 major donors, many of whom have made gifts worth of $1 million or more. Her latest book, which she is presenting today, offers a robust response based on both theory and extensive evidence to the dominant critiques against big giving. She has also written a range of reports, including 10 editions of the annual Couts Million Pounds Donor Report. I would like to let Dr. Breeze present her work. She will talk for about 25 to 30 minutes, after which we're going to open the floor for a broad discussion. I ask you meanwhile to reserve your question at the end of the talk. And if you have questions that you'd like me to ask, or please put them in the chat and we'll go from there. So thank you so much, and make sure your microphones are muted. Beth, your turn.
Thank you so much, Paloma. Let me just share my screen, if I may. There we go. How does that look? Can you see me? See the slides? Wonderful. Well, so lovely to see some names popping up and some faces. Callum, I saw you. I'm delighted you're there. Hello. And Paloma, thank you for introducing me. Hi, Callum. It's really great to be back with the Philanthropy and Nonprofit Leadership Programme at Carleton University, because actually, even if I'm only back on screen, this is where this whole piece of work began. I was incredibly lucky to spend the summer of 2019 visiting the programme, and that's when I got to know Paloma and Callum and Susan and many other people at your wonderful institution. So this is where I began working on this book. I had some great conversations with the faculty, with the students at the time, with board members, with other contacts, and they definitely helped shape my argument. However, it's my argument, no one else is responsible for it, and you may all have different takes on the issues I'm going to talk about, and I'm genuinely looking forward to hearing what your take and your perhaps different views might be afterwards. So without further ado, this is what the book covers. It's called In Defense of Philanthropy. I did change it to an S for the front slide, in defense. So that was noticed. This is what it covers. And my argument in a nutshell, because I think sometimes it's best just to begin with your punchline. So here's my punchline. I think that hypercriticism of philanthropy underestimates the complexity of its target of philanthropy, and it carries a significant risk of curtailing rather than improving the philanthropic impulse. So before I get into what I mean by all of that, one thing that comes up quite often is people say to me, does philanthropy really need defending? I mean, come on, who's attacking it? Now, I've got a ton of examples that there are, you know, there is deep and entrenched and long-standing criticism of philanthropy. As you can see, there's a whole chapter on it, is philanthropy really under attack? And I really enjoyed writing that. I get examples all the way back to the 1500s and beyond of donors being lampooned and criticized and effigies of them being burnt and all kinds of things. But it's good to have some fresh examples. So here's a fresh example just to kick us off so you know what it is I'm talking about. This book came out earlier this month and arrived through my letterbox last week, I think. I've heard the author speak, Ted Lechterman. I think he's currently at Oxford. I think he was at Stanford first and then the Hertie School in Berlin. He is far more thoughtful and the argument will be far more sophisticated than the title suggests. But nonetheless, the title that's been used, The Tyranny of Generosity and Why Philanthropy Corrupts Our Politics, this is what I feel we're up against. And I think there's a need for a counterbalance that argues for the positive role and potential of generosity as expressed through philanthropy. And you know, the reason that I think that is because if we even take a moment to reflect on our own giving, I'm pretty confident in saying that everyone on this call will have made a donation at some time or another. You know, we're all givers, we're all receivers as well, actually, we all benefit from philanthropy. But when we give, we're often driven by personal connections and experiences, what others have called our philanthropic autobiography. You know, things happen to us, we get illnesses or we know about parts of the world or issues affect us. And that's what prompts our giving. That's why cancer research is the most popular cause year after year, because everyone knows somebody who's had cancer. Donors are also driven by compassion, by empathy, by gratitude. You might have given to organizations that you've benefited from, like a theater or a university or a hospital, for example. Humanitarian beliefs, just the belief that, you know, the world shouldn't be like that. Frustration at the way things are. You know, anger is a really under-recognized motivation behind giving. You know, the world shouldn't be like that. I want to do something about it. Those who make very big donations often talk as well about wanting to set an example for their kids. Although, to be honest, giving smaller donations is also valuable. If your kids see you giving, then that role modeling will help them to be raised as philanthropic children. The wealthy also talk about the right use of money, the desire to achieve something meaningful that they can be proud of. To leave a legacy, have a life that's been well lived. They also, and this is from 15 years of interviewing big donors, they also almost always talk about the joy of giving, how much more fun it is to spend the money in that way than to, you know, play golf or get a yacht or just spend idle days. It's, you know, they get to meet interesting people, they get to be involved in things. It's far more pleasurable than buying more stuff. So those are the kind of things that I hear when I, in my job researching philanthropy, and as Paloma mentioned, I used to be a fundraiser as well. So when I met donors in that role, you know, that's how donors themselves, and as I say, you yourselves might think about your own giving. It's personal connection, it's compassion, it's the pleasure at giving, and so on. So the simple reason that I decided to write this book, to write A Defense of Philanthropy, is because of what to me was a very clear mismatch between those kind of conversations and those kind of words and motivations, and the way that philanthropy has become increasingly depicted in critical commentaries. So what do I mean by that? Well, critics say things like philanthropy is just a tax dodge. Big philanthropy is always an exercise in power. Philanthropies fund the wrong things in the wrong way at the wrong time. Philanthropy causes more harm than good. That's pretty damning. It causes more harm than good overall. And some critics genuinely put that forward as a point that they think is proven. People also think philanthropists are hypocrites. You often get this on social media. Their donations are such a tiny fraction of their wealth that it's really meaningless. And of course, people within the philanthropy sector hear and respond to this chorus of criticism. So a donor told me, you need to accept from the outset that whatever you do will be rubbished. I particularly worry about young inheritees and those who haven't yet made their money, saying things like, I don't believe in philanthropy anymore. And that came from a colleague who works with young inheritees. Also, non-profit staff, you know, fundraisers, grant makers, charity leaders, they worry and hear these criticisms and these comments too. And one young fundraiser said to me, she said, I became a fundraiser because I wanted to help. And now I wonder if I'm in the right job. So the book I've written that I'm going to share with you, I was going to say tonight, but of course for you it's lunchtime, is prompted, as I say, by this mismatch between the lived experience that I've certainly come across in my interactions with donors, and this growing chorus of criticisms that presents philanthropy as being sort of fundamentally flawed and irretrievably flawed even, a sort of facade for self-promotion and a sham and a scam. So just to give you a few more examples of what I mean, and when I was presented the very embryonic version of this talk back in July or 2019, might have been August 2019, I shared that what got me going really on this path was in 2006 when I began my PhD. That was the year that the Gates got together with Warren Buffett and merged their philanthropic fortunes even. And the media coverage in the UK was quite critical. Now, he's giving billions to charity, so what else could he do with his money except coat himself in treacle and roll in banknotes? Now, it's not a particularly incisive or even egregious, you know, criticism, but it's dismissive. You know, these people are getting together, most of the money to be spent on global health, saving lives across the world. And the instinct is to just sniff at it and to be dismissive. So that was 2006. That then got me on a bit of a train of looking at media coverage and seeing what I could see about how people talk about philanthropy. And 10 years later, the Zuckerbergs left their made their pledge, to put 99% of their Facebook shares, which then was worth, I think, $45 billion, into their philanthropic work. And again, the UK media said, was anyone else left underwhelmed by the unbearable arrogance of Mark Zuckerberg? I won't read out the quotes on the right-hand side. Somebody once called it PowerPoint karaoke when you just read what's on the screen. And you can see for yourself, these are just examples of some of the things that are in the British press about the dismissive way of thinking about philanthropy and philanthropists. And as I say, it does affect the donors. They say, I'm afraid of the media. And they've got great power. There's no right of reply. Why are the media nasty? They're nice about you in your obituary, but other than that, there's nothing can be done. So you might say to yourself, look, come on, this is just Bill Gates, Mark Zuckerberg. These are just the same old faces. There's far more to philanthropy than just them. And I would completely agree with you. So let's think about some other faces. Last year in 2020, the world's biggest donor was Mackenzie Scott. Now, I'm sure you all know that she's an author in her own right, but most commonly she's described as the former partner of Amazon founder Jeff Bezos. So she's publicly pledged to give away her $50 billion divorce settlement. And she got off to a flying start, distributing around $6 billion in her first year. And many people thought the way she did it in terms of ceding power, giving unrestricted, the way she explained her giving, marked a sort of a change in how philanthropy was done. But nonetheless, here's some examples of some media coverage of it. So Vanity Fair interpreted her giving spree, as they called it. I mean, that's a nice undermining phrase, isn't it? Giving spree, $6 billion for good causes. They described it as a way of getting back or showing up her former spouse. As you can see on the slide, they use slightly more colourful language than that, but I won't read it out. This is philanthropy as soap opera. Of course, it's a gendered interpretation, but it's looking for the catch. Why is she really doing it? What's the real unworthy reason, motivation behind that giving? There was more serious coverage in papers like the Washington Post and the UK's Independent, and they use Scott's giving as an opportunity to question how capitalism works. So we should consider it less as a sign of goodwill and more an indication of a system that's far out of whack, said the Post. We need a proper taxation system, says the Independent. Now, I am not here to argue that the world is right as it is. There is plenty of evidence that inequality is bad for us all, rich or poor. But what I want to say to you, what seems to me curious, is that the premise of a capitalist society and whether the tax system is fit for purpose or not seems to be only questioned when someone tries to do good, rather than when they buy a private jet or do something else with their money. But you don't get these headlines when people spend their money on private consumption. It's only when philanthropic acts hit the headlines. So that makes me, as a sociologist, curious about what's going on. What's the motivation of the critics? So in some ways, it's a critique of the critics. I've talked so far about real life donors, but actually popular culture is just as influential a force on how we think about things. So let me just share a couple of examples from that sphere of life. I don't know about in Canada, but everyone was absolutely delighted in the UK to have James Bond finally on our big screens after what seemed like an interminable wait. My local cinema has been showing it 5 times a day ever since it came out. We're all delighted it's back. But that franchise, the James Bond franchise, like many other fictional storytelling, has successfully capitalized on the public's fears about philanthropic motivations and the suspicion that those claiming to do good are really baddies in disguise. That's a sort of fairly common trope. So if any of you remember the 22nd Bond film, Quantum of Solace, as an example, Daniel Craig's super spy is in the MI6 building. And he's being briefed about his next assignment by M's chief of staff, who explains that Dominic Green, who's the baddie, has been doing a lot of philanthropic work. He's been buying up large tracts of land for ecological preservation. Now, of course, cue lots of car chases, boat chases, plane chases, and very glamorous fundraising functions, which certainly didn't ring true from my experience as a fundraiser. And in the end, Bond confronts Green in the Bolivian desert, where his cover as an environmental philanthropist is literally blown up. Because guess what? He's not really an environmentalist. He's in league with a newly installed dictator trying to control Bolivia's water supply so that the population can be exploited and terrorized. Now, of course, this is a fictional deception, but I think it reflects this commonly held view of philanthropists that they pretend to care about social and environmental issues, but in reality, they're doing all they can to prop up a system from which they benefit the most, and that's responsible for the very harms that they pretend to care about. Let me share you with you one more example of why I think of a defence of philanthropy is needed. And this is actually prompted by when I finished the first draft of the book, I had, of course, neglected my kids for a while I was writing it. And when I finished, I said, look, let's just watch a movie tonight. You can choose whatever movie you want. And they chose the Muppets reboot. I think it was 2011 Muppets film, the first of the new ones. And what, as you probably know, what happens in that movie is that the anarchic puppets reunite to try and raise $10 million to save the Muppets Theatre from being demolished. But who is the scheming archetypical baddie with a maniacal laugh, of course, who's pretending to have a sympathetic interest in preserving the building and yet fully intending to tear it down to drill for oil? As Kermit explains, it's oil baron Tex Richmond, the wealthy philanthropist. Well, of course he is. He's a philanthropist. So I wrote The Defense of Philanthropy because of James Bond, because of Kermit and many other Hollywood plot lines, because of those newspaper headlines, and all those who are grandstanding on social media about egotistical and tax-dodging donors. And as well, my colleagues and friends and others who say, but isn't it really all about tax? Isn't it really just they want to get their name on a building? All those who are really increasingly suspicious that philanthropy is at best a ruse, and as it at worst is causing more harm than good. I think it's also worth pointing out that critics believe themselves to be saying something really new, and to be boldly tackling a taboo by criticising philanthropy, when in fact history is full of examples of donors' motivations and impact being questioned. I'll just share a few of them here. So for centuries, it was thought that big givers were simply trying to buy their way into eternal life, you know, passport to paradise, helping only on a Sunday to get to heaven. At the start of the 20th century, quite famously, Andrew Carnegie and John D. Rockefeller, when they tried to establish their endowed foundations, they were knocked back and described as a menace to the welfare of the nation. And as already mentioned, there's no shortage of attacks on social media and in popular culture. So it's not fundamentally new to be critiquing philanthropy, but I think the critique has really ramped up in recent years. And if I had to pinpoint one moment in time when I think hypercriticism took hold, I think it would probably be earlier in that year when I visited Carlton in January 2019, after the World Economics Forum in Davos, when the Dutch historian Rutger Bregman said, just stop talking about stupid philanthropy schemes, we should be talking about taxes, taxes, taxes. Now, he said that when he was asked about what corporations should do to prevent a social backlash, but his words struck a global chord relating to all private giving, including that by individuals and foundations. So people were very receptive to an attack on philanthropy, especially when it's positioned as an alternative to higher levying of taxes and more generous welfare states. I think we all understand his point perfectly, and I certainly do. But one of the most straightforward responses to this kind of critiques is that it's perfectly possible to be in favour of tax reform, you know, everyone paying their dues, closing all the loopholes, paying more so we can have a more generous welfare state, and also at the same time being in favour of philanthropy. This is not an unusual position, even by donors themselves. I mean, the archetypical big donor Bill Gates is on record saying that he and his fellow rich Americans should pay more than they currently do towards taxes. And there are organizations, the Patriotic Millionaires and Millionaires for Humanity, who have sent public letters and said that they should be taxed more and would like that to happen. So this idea that tax is good and philanthropy is bad, that you have to pick one of those funding mechanisms, you know, I'm team tax and you're team philanthropy, it's untrue and it's unhelpful. They're not opposites. Philanthropy often cooperates with and complements government action, as well as sometimes challenging it. I think those of us who've worked in the nonprofit sector know that's the case, that the funding streams often come from those different sources. So this takes me to the first of the three mutually reinforcing critiques of philanthropy that I think have landed very successfully in recent years, and that I tried to identify and offer a defense against in the book. So the first of them is what I call the academic critique. Here are three key examples of books that have set out this critique, and their titles give you a good idea of the arguments that are inside. I always want to give a good name check to Lindsay McGoey, actually, the first of the book. She's a Canadian based in the UK now. And as is often the case, a woman made the point first and then some men made it later and no one seems to remember the woman who wrote the first book. So I'm very happy to sort of put to highlight the fact that Lindsay's book came first. But her book, you know, The Price of Philanthropy, The Wealth, Power and Philanthropy in a New Gilded Age, Why Philanthropy is Failing Democracy, you know, these hint at the arguments that are inside the covers. The main concern of these authors is that private giving is an undemocratic exercise in power. And they worry that unelected and unaccountable people get to choose what does and doesn't get funded just because they're rich, and that their whims are generously subsidized by tax breaks. And these critics often believe that big donors want to replace government and that encouraging philanthropy will result in plutocracy, the rule of the wealthy. So it's quite a set of criticisms that are put forward by this set of authors. And how do we respond to them? Well, I think firstly, we have to agree there's some truth in them. Donors are not elected and they can support what they choose, though, of course, only within the rules that have been decided by elected bodies. So voters do get the final say on what is and isn't defined as charitable and whether charity tax breaks exist or not and what level they're set at. Those are all decided by elected bodies. But nonetheless, within that, there's a lot of donor choice. But I still think there's three ways we can respond to these concerns. Firstly, to say that there's a long and impressive history of undemocratic, but nonetheless valuable interventions. As anyone who's, you know, campaigned or been an activist or been in the nonprofit sector knows, social progress doesn't just happen without concerted effort. And that effort usually needs some funding to make it possible. So private money has supported efforts to end slavery, to end child labour in factories, to give women the vote, to allow same-sex marriage, and so on. In healthy democracies, new ideas need to arise and existing choices need to be challenged. And I think that one of philanthropy's most powerful roles is to help improve democracy through outside pressure, funding research, advocacy, and campaigns, and just showing a different way to do things. Secondly, we need to remember that tax breaks are not a unique feature of the world of philanthropy. Now, governments offer a huge range of tax incentives to encourage people to do all kinds of things. In my household at the moment, we're looking at buying an electric car, and that will get a tax break. They'll be cheaper to buy the car, be cheaper to run it, we won't have to pay for certain licenses, because what's happening is the government's trying to nudge us to making that better choice. Similarly, I can get nudged to set up a pension, to open a business in certain areas, to do all kinds of things. So altogether, the UK government spends about 400 billion each year on these kind of incentives. And of those 400 billion, 2 billion is spent on nudges, incentives for people to give. So it's really a very small fraction, and it's a similar fraction in the US, and perhaps you could tell me if it's the same in Canada. So again, going back to the point I made earlier about why do we worry about this kind of spending and not that kind of spending, I would ask, why is there so much on those tax focus on those tax incentives to encourage philanthropy, which at least has to have some public benefit, even if the donor gets something out of it? Unlike, you know, I don't see much public criticism or lengthy books criticizing the existence of tax incentives for me to set up a pension pot, which is purely for my personal benefit. And thirdly, I think that academic critics misunderstand the goals of philanthropy. I've never met any big donor who's got any interest in replacing government spending. They know that that's not possible. And even the richest people alive today simply don't have enough money to do that. The sums and figures that are involved are just not feasible. The Gateses have distributed about $55 billion over the 20 years that their foundation has been going. That would fund the World Health Organization or the World Food Programme for a couple of years at most. Mackenzie Scott last year was the single biggest donor with her $6 billion. That wouldn't cover the cost of the health or education budget in even a small state for 1 year. So the figures just don't add up to suggest that plutocracy is a viable outcome of encouraging philanthropy. But more importantly, donors have no desire to replace government, you know, to become a sort of glorified self-funding public servant. They want to do something additional, something extra that they can point to and feel good about. There's no philanthropic joy in simply taking over a government function. And I think the critics know this. And again, it just arouses my curiosity. Why would you suggest something is possible when the numbers and the evidence doesn't add up to suggest that's the case? I'm going to run through the other two critiques more quickly and happy to go back to them in more detail in the Q&A. So the second critique that I write about is what I call the insider critique. And as the name suggests, this comes from people within the nonprofit sector who are keen to question mostly what donors give to. And here's examples of some books and organizations that have done that. So this critique questions whether that the causes that are chosen and prioritised by donors are the correct ones, and the basis on which philanthropic spending should be allocated, and whether or not better decisions could be made and how. This critique certainly dates back many years. If we look to the late 19th century, the charity organisation societies were established for precisely this reason, to correct the misplaced priorities of Victorian donors and encouraging them to follow the scientific principles in allocating their donations. So people have always wanted to tell other people that they should be giving differently and giving to something else. The latest iteration of this train of thought is the effective altruism movement, which I think has played a really positive role in many ways in encouraging younger professionals, university students and younger sort of graduates to think about giving and to increase the amount that they give. But I think it's also got a danger in it, that it suggests there's only one way to give. It can be quite sort of evangelical in you know, this is the way to do it and every other way is wrong. And I think that just adds to the noise that philanthropy is often done wrong. So to take one example, effective altruists very often advocate funding cheap life-saving interventions like deworming pills or malaria nets. These are definitely worth funding. I mean, you know, you pay $5 for a malaria net and it will very likely save a life. You know, that is an amazing opportunity. But that $5 opportunity is standing on the shoulders of many, many other acts over the years, which many of which have been funded by philanthropy, going all the way back to the early 1900s, when scientists at the Liverpool School of Tropical Medicine first established that mosquitoes carry the malaria, are the carriers of malaria, as well as donors who've contributed to developing the drugs to treat malaria, those who've designed the nets, the distribution networks, the health education professionals, their training, their education, and so on. So it's very reductionist, is my point, to say that only give to this and nothing else, because it promotes this idea that you can simply ignore all that comes before the very cheap intervention. And I think it also promotes a rather unhelpful idea of sort of heroic individualism, like I saved, you know, by my $10, you know, I can count the number of lives I've saved. I think that's very much not in keeping with how we should or would want to think about how philanthropy works and how we're all mutually interdependent. And it disregards the contribution of so many others to the process, including the beneficiary population. So thirdly, the populist critique. I find this the easiest to criticize because it's the most obviously unhelpful. So this, like all kinds of populism, the populist critique offers misleadingly simple answers to very complex questions. So here's some examples on the screen. Populists allow no room for any motive other than self-interest. Giving always has a hidden agenda. It's a cover up for bad behavior. It's a sneaky way to gain advantages. You know, giving is just taking in disguise. It's selfishness dressed up as selflessness. We find it all over social media, mocking big givers. We find it in popular bestsellers that describe philanthropy as an elite charade that funds fake change. As I said at the start, if we just take a moment to consider our own giving, we know that donor motivation is far more complex. It can't be reduced to one selfish driver. You know, it's always a mixed motive. I think sometimes these critiques have mixed up voluntary with altruism, and they're not the same thing. You know, philanthropy is voluntary. That doesn't mean the donor doesn't get something out of it, whether it's a student volunteering to build their CV, whether it's somebody giving so that they can feel good about themselves or have their name on, you know, their family name, you know, promoted. But mixed motives is the norm. There's reams of research, decades of research that show mixed motives are the norm for both big and small givers. But what really frustrates me about the populist critique is this misunderstanding that donors exist in a vacuum, as if the sort of planet philanthropy, it's okay to knock and criticize that, and that everything that they do and support exists in another world. And I suppose that's one of the things I'm keenest to do with this book, to show the connection between the donors and the doers. I think it's illogical to appreciate non-profit philanthropically funded work, which most people do. They like charities, they like non-profits, but not to appreciate the philanthropists, the people providing the funding. They need each other, donors and doers. It's a partnership. And I think we're moving closer to using that kind of language, their mutual independence. And actually, philanthropy is the more vicarious partner. I was speaking to a very thoughtful donor recently, and he said to me, you know, everything that I'm proud of, all of our successes and all of our impacts that we claim, they're actually achieved by working with and through nonprofit partners. So everything we achieve is because of other people. So it's a profoundly vicarious activity being a philanthropist. So I think what's happening here is that the populace are focusing on the money, and that's understandable because money, you know, is of popular interest, but it's really unhelpful because money alone can't achieve anything. But lots of things can't be achieved without financial support. And so that's why I think we need to explain the real role that philanthropy can and does play. So that's the three critiques. Why do I think they stick? Let me end with this. Firstly, I think they stick because of an awful lot of misconceptions out there about philanthropy. This slide could have been a lot longer, but I think five of the biggest misconceptions are on the screen just now. It's assumed to be the preserve of the rich, but even the slightest look at the data shows that it's actually the massed cumulative collection donations of the rest of us that far outweigh the donations of the 1% or the ultra mega rich. It's not only or largely conducted through charitable trusts and foundations. Again, it's individuals. Corporates are also there as well as part of the story. There's a misunderstanding that the only real or proper goal of philanthropy is to help the poor and to tackle inequality. They are absolutely key goals, and philanthropy has always had a focus on poverty and welfare and inequality, but it's always also done other things, whether it's providing public baths or theatres, excellence in sports and the arts, opportunities and so on. So it's not only about poverty and inequality. I've already talked about the fact that it's not a viable alternative to state funding, and nobody thinks that, and yet this has become a key part of the critiques. And then, again, I'd love to hear what you think about this, because you're much closer geographically to the US, but I think the American experience of philanthropy is always considered the norm in these critiques. You know, the American population is only 4% of the global population, and yet they dominate 99% of the critiques. And I get frustrated when they talk about philanthropy as if it's the same thing everywhere and at all time. If there are local issues and things that need fixing in US philanthropy, or more likely in US politics, if there's government failure around the funding of education and health and so on, then fix that, but don't blame philanthropy for it. So why else do I think that these critiques stick? Well, I found a very useful concept from psychology when I'm thinking about it. It may or may not be useful to you. But psychologists have come up with this concept of do-gooder derogation, which is basically a way of understanding how and why good behaviour, like being a vegetarian, like being an environmentalist, like I would say being a philanthropist, sometimes ends up being disparaged rather than applauded. So it's got three parts to it. And I think each of these parts or stages relates to the three critiques that I've mentioned already. So firstly, observers deny the existence of any virtue. They favour alternative self-interested explanations. So, you know, you're not really doing good because you're altruistic, you're pursuing power, or you've really got a secret agenda for plutocracy. You know, that's what's really going on. The second stage from this concept is about trivialising donors. So, and I think this is seen in the insider critique. You know, you might be well-intentioned, but you're naive. You're unaware of the realities of the world. You haven't done the maths. You're doing it wrong. And if those two strategies fail, if you can't deny the virtue and if you can't trivialise philanthropy away, then the very simple way is simply to encourage dislike of donors. And that's, of course, what the populists do. You know, you're a bad person, a hypocrite, you're a self-centred, you know, wolf in sheep's clothing and so on. Now, it's not just that this is often unfair and unlikely to be true, because like any group of people, philanthropists will have all kinds of characteristics, good and bad. So it's not, I've not written this book because I'm worried about the thin skin of rich donors, although I don't think it's fair to be, you know, careless or cruel, you know, to anybody. But that's not, you know, that's not my main motivation, really. I want to avoid the demoralization of all those who are involved in philanthropy. So going back to the earlier slide, the fundraiser who thinks I'm in the wrong gig, the young inheritor who thinks they're not going to get involved in philanthropy. I worry about deterring future big givers from stepping up. I worry about fundraisers not being able to do their job. Why would that matter? Because all of this derogation and criticism is unlikely to lead to more people giving. And if we want to encourage behavior, normally we use carrots and praise and more positive methods. If you think about the basic sort of behavioral economics of nudging, we don't encourage behavior by dissing it. we need to use much more positive measures. So if we discourage philanthropy, if we undermine its reputation and knock it, and we end up with less givers, that means less money for good causes. And that impact will be felt most by the beneficiaries, not the donors. So that's what the note I want to end on, really. Where do these critiques take us, other than to despair and discouragement of philanthropy? So it's not that I think we shouldn't critique and challenge. You know, look, I'm an academic. Many of you are involved, you know, in a university. Criticism is a key part of what we do. And quite rightly, we should ask questions. But the question is, what happens next after we've raised those questions? If it's all analysis and no solutions, then we are going against Noah's principle, which I rather like. I nicked this from Raymond Levy's book on fundraising. You know, if solutions are sorely lacking, we shouldn't be giving any credit for just predicting rain, credit only for building arcs. So let's criticize, let's ask questions, but let's also then move on from that point to say what next. So what can be done? Firstly, I think we should end the ahistorical, unnuanced and the ad hominem attacks on philanthropists. They've just got no place really in grown-up debate. You know the kind of thing I mean, the Vanity Fair Mackenzie Scott thing. What's that got to do with anything? Secondly, I think we need to disentangle critiques of philanthropy from critiques of wealth and inequality. And the only big donor I've heard push back on these critiques is Melinda French Gates. And it was a very, very brief pushback. She said, I'm not sure that the attack has been on philanthropy. I think the attack has been on wealth. And I think that's true. I think philanthropy's got caught in the crossfires of other debates because philanthropists are often the most visible winners of the capitalist system. They're the most visible rich people. But of course, a moment's reflection would make you think there's an awful lot of non-givers out there who perhaps would be a more worthy target of that critique. And thirdly, of course, we must improve the practice of philanthropy. And that's where I think the sector has more to say than critics give them credit for. Because often really what the critics are saying is that philanthropy isn't perfect. Well, of course, philanthropy isn't perfect. They're right about that. What they fail to add is that the government sector isn't perfect and the for-profit sector isn't perfect. They're all imperfect, but they all have a unique and crucial role to play. So improving the practice of philanthropy seems to me the most useful thing we can do. What does that look like? Well, based on 10 years as a practitioner and 15 years of studying and meeting donors and attending endless conferences, commissions, events, you know, there's a whole drive out there by the philanthropy sector to improve. These are sort of the three main bodies of improvement that I see already happening. This isn't really a prescription for what should happen. This is the conversations that are already taking place, and some of you may be involved in them. So, and I think we can organize them again in response to the three different critiques that I mentioned. So just to briefly pull out some points. So more ethical philanthropy, I think, would help respond to the academic critique. So incorporating social justice, racial justice, and environmental justice, making sure that the investments of philanthropic capital are mission aligned, being much more aware and careful about power dynamics, and collaborating and using the language of partnership. I think that effective philanthropy can help us respond to the insider critique. As I say, every donor I've met wants to be effective, but what does that actually mean? Well, donor education, taking expert advice, learning about problems, taking evaluation seriously, and championing representation across all aspects of giving. And I think that more trust-based philanthropy, a phrase which is, you know, heard more and more often this past year, can help us respond to the populist critiques. So simplifying and streamlining grant making, which certainly happened during COVID conditions in the UK, and I would imagine in Canada too, making multi-year unrestricted core funding the default option, not just a handful of donors doing that, being flexible, asking only for necessary reporting, you know, just being generally more respectful of the philanthropic partners. So there are many ways in which philanthropy can be and is being improved. And I just want to say that when I've debated with critics, I've sometimes said to them, tell me what, you know, you've been criticising philanthropy for 10 or 15 or even 20 years. Which of the improvements over the last 10 or 15 or 20 years do you think are the most, you know, which ones have you noticed? Which ones are you, would you think are good? And I don't get an answer to that question. So I sat down and I just tried to come up with, you know, one thing a year that had changed. And this is a fairly UK-centric list. Forgive me for not putting the date of the Carlton programme on there. But each year, you know, a new book, a new organisation, a new institution coming out to try and improve, educate donors and improve philanthropy. There is lots going on. And I think the critics are either unaware of it or they're unwilling to acknowledge it. And I think that is a problem. So that's what I wanted to say. I wrote this book because I think that the current waves of critiques are mutually reinforcing. They're overstating the threat posed by philanthropy and they're understating its positive benefits. I've said enough, Paloma, and I'd love to hear what other people think. So thanks very much for listening.
Thank you so much. I think I really invite everyone to pick up the book and engage with the arguments. I have already a couple of questions that were sent to me, but I'd like to kind of start the discussion a bit on, as I was reading the book, one of the reactions I had when reading the examples were often based on the premise that philanthropists start with good intention, and that might be the case in general. But we know how much scandals, how much problematic behavior also contributes to this reputation. But I didn't quite see this in your argument. So how do you think that plays into your critique? And what do you have to say about this philanthropy that is more regressive and not necessarily targeting causes that are inherently seen as for the public good?
Thank you, Paloma. Yeah, I mean, I know what you mean. It's easy to name problematic philanthropy. I try to go for as many days as I can without saying, you know, certain words like Sackler or Koch brothers. But, you know, we know what you're talking about. The problem then is the generalization. You know, you can pick a couple of bad apples and then just condemn the whole orchard. And I think actually the onus is on the critics of philanthropy to argue that they are typical. All I'm saying is philanthropy can be good. And mine is the easier argument to prove. I'm not saying it's always good. By any means, you know, philanthropy is fallible because people are fallible. So if you get some people who have ideas that we don't agree with or we think are wrong or behave badly, that's because people are like that. I'm simply saying it can be done well. It does have positive value. And that if you're saying it's all an elite charade, philanthropy is always about power, it causes more harm than good, then the onus is on those people to do more than just say the same couple of names again and again. And I think one of the things I tried to do in the book, which I think has been helpful to practitioners, is to give a whole load of other names of people who are operating in a much more humble way, who've had successes that are pretty undeniable in terms of causing, you know, millions of lives saved, gun control in the UK, you know, donating art to non-elite institutions, just as many examples of I can, to say you can't just keep saying a couple of names and thinking you've won the argument. It's just not good enough. It's not a very robust methodology, I would say. It certainly wouldn't pass an exam in philanthropic studies if you did that.
Thank you. I had a question from Jennifer Locilento. I don't know, Jennifer, if you can unmute and ask your question.
Thanks, Loma. First, I just want to say, Beth, as a practicing fundraiser, how much I appreciate the lens that you bring to your academic work. And it's something I really see as a differentiator when you're, because you're able to talk about when I talk to donors. And I think there's a difference there with some of the critiques that you mentioned. Those folks aren't actually out talking to donors. So I just really appreciate and want to say that as a fundraiser, I feel seen by your work. The question I want to ask you is really about transferring some of your observations to the Canadian context. Mm-hmm. You commented, of course, we're close to the States. We're also overshadowed by the States in many ways, but not everything translates exactly. And so I wonder if it's a question of, can we in Canada get ahead of some of this, or is there anything that we can learn from the experience of the UK and the US that can help to diffuse the criticisms of philanthropy or perhaps make the arguments more nuanced?
Thank you, Juniper. Yeah, no, I mean, it's funny because the reaction when I've shared the book, often fundraisers and practitioners have a bit of a sigh of relief. Like they kind of knew philanthropy wasn't that bad, but it's just helpful to see it articulated and to see some counterexamples. Funnily enough, the people who often are the least convinced are donors themselves, who I think are still kind of worrying about, you know, what they've done and, you know, what they're doing and the source of their wealth, what have you. So, but I'm glad that it's useful to practitioners. That's certainly a goal, because a demoralized workforce is not going to manage it. You know, fundraising is hard enough without people, you know, questioning the morals of the people you're raising funds from. I wish I could say that there's more to learn from the UK, because I think we are in the same position where, you know, people say philanthropy is X, Y, and Z, and we just repeat it as if as if nothing is, you know, nothing's different in the two countries. We have a national health system, you know, we don't have the issue of needing to be reliant on philanthropy for meeting medical emergencies. And yet those critiques come over here quite straightforwardly. So Juniper, all I can say is you could try doing what I do, which is when I hear that, I say, oh, which philanthropy? Where is that happening? Could you give me, and just pinpoint, so almost trying to just gently stop people using the word philanthropy as if it's self-evident and the same everywhere. Oh, you know, is that how it is in Johannesburg? Is that how it is in Melbourne? Is that how it is in Aberdeen? You know, they say, oh no, I mean Silicon Valley big white male philanthropy. Well, say that then, if that's your problem, and there may well be issues there that need fixing, but don't extrapolate from a very, very small slice of private giving and make it harder for people to raise money in Johannesburg and Melbourne and Aberdeen. So that's what I would say. So you could try pushing back in that way.
Thank you. I have a question from Hillary Pearson. I don't know, Hillary, if you want to unmute yourself and ask a question, or you prefer that I read it.
That's fine. I can ask it. Hi, Beth.
Hi.
You. So Beth and I are very much in line with each other. And as Beth knows, I'm trying to write a book about, I am writing a book about Canadian, not philanthropy in its broad sense, but Canadian foundations as an aspect of philanthropy. Because I think foundations are quite different in many ways from individual donors. But my question is actually about, and I guess I'd like to have your perspective, Beth, on accountability, and particularly from an institutional philanthropy perspective. You know, the Power Critique in particular talks about you know, the lack of accountability, the unelected nature of philanthropy. And I'd be interested to know what forms you think institutional philanthropic accountability can take. You know, there's a push, I think, for greater transparency, but there's a kind of, I've certainly encountered this in Canada, there's an inherent contradiction between private motivations, which push for anonymity, really, and public expectations, which push for transparency. And, you know, one of the things I've said a lot is that private foundations or private philanthropy, but particularly private foundations, are not private the minute they become registered charities, because they have to, they have a minimal public accountability. They have to report to a government regulator. That means you can't hide behind the cloak of complete anonymity. But how much more do you have to do to, I think, counter this elements of legitimacy in this Power Critique?
Thank you, Hilary. It's a great question, and good luck with your book. I think often people imagine that there's that things are more opaque than they are. I mean, every time a story hits the news in the UK, we've had a couple of stories recently about renamings of Oxford colleges and various donors involved. And it's really not difficult to go onto the Charity Commission website and find all the documents from those organisations, their governing document, who's on their trustee board, their annual reports and accounts. You know, it is there. So sometimes, you know, just because somebody hasn't done the research, you know, and then they say, oh, you know, we don't know anything about these donors. You say, no, it's there. You wouldn't expect it in any other area of life that, oh, and I don't know what that company's doing. Well, it's all there at company's house. So I think partly we can push back by saying, a bit like the answer to Juniper, what's the information you can't find? You know, what is it you want to know? And gently point out to them that there is more there than perhaps they thought. But I think also what your question raises is one of the really key lose-lose scenarios, because if people talk about, and I know more about individuals than foundations, so forgive me for using that example, but if a donor is quite public about their giving, you know, puts their name on it, or, you know, very publicly associates themselves with it, they often get shot down, or it's just ego, it's just, you know, power and domination, what have you. If they don't, if they give anonymously or secretly, oh, well, that's suspicious. What's your secret agenda? What are you trying to achieve? And I think as soon as you spot one of those lose-lose scenarios, they're not really, the critics are not worried about what's happening. They just don't like philanthropy, because whatever you do, it's gonna annoy people. So I think it's quite helpful to point out that there isn't really any, like, what would a philanthropist have to do to vindicate themselves? Is there any way in which they can please the critics? And if the answer's no, then I think that maybe tells us a bit more about the critics than it does about the donor. So yeah, I think that's part of what I'd say. The other part is that what people don't know, there's a sort of selection bias, isn't there? We know about the donations that have happened, either because the name's on or the paperwork's there. What we don't know is about when donations are not don't come about. You know, donations have to be accepted as well as given. And one of the things I found most enjoyable doing the research for this book is discovering how often nonprofit organisations or communities had said no, thank you, or no way, we don't want that. And a good example is the Carnegie library scheme. And everybody knows there's a couple of thousand Carnegie libraries across the world. I didn't know until I did the research that about 225, I think was it, communities said no, we don't want a Carnegie library, either because they had other priorities, you know, they'd rather do road building or build a school rather than a library, and because of course you had to pay for the upkeep, or some of them just didn't like the man himself and didn't want his money. So you can say no, and there's more power. So your question about power, those receiving do have, they're not dupes, they don't just have to take. If someone waves a wad of money, you don't have to take it. And I think that perhaps we can remind ourselves of that nonprofit organizations, they are often cash strapped, but they still have to make good choices about whose money they take and for what, and if it doesn't fit with their mission and it doesn't you know, if they don't want to take it, they don't have to. So I think it's just good to remind people of that as well.
Thank you, Beth. I have a question here. I have two questions in my chat. One from Ruth Hansen. Ruth, do you mind asking a question?
Hi, I apologize. My camera is up much higher than I am, but Beth, good to see you. Paloma, good to see you. Okay, first of all, quick comment. I love your vision of improved philanthropy. I was just jotting it all down, but clearly I should just buy the book.
okay.
The question part is, okay, so love your inspiration. When we think about the Muppets raising money for their cause, or in my case, my favorite, the Blues Brothers, how does that fit into the vision or the depiction of philanthropy? Are they philanthropists? Follow up, if they are philanthropists, why do you think they've escaped criticism, or have they?
So I think I know what you mean, but just to check. So when people give smaller amounts of money, they don't tend to be criticized, but it's the bigger sums. Yeah, I think that's spot on, Ruth. And I think the idea that, you know, the more zeros you have, the less likely you are to be altruistic, or in fact, it's impossible to be altruistic if you're super wealthy, is clearly a logically flawed proposition. I mean, if I win the lottery tonight, tomorrow, do I become a bad person? You know, I'm still the same person. And a book that came out last year that I really enjoyed was Lisa Greer's Philanthropy Revolution, which tells the story, a firsthand account of what it's like to be a fairly ordinary person who's, you know, they make a lot of money. Her husband invents the machinery that allows 3D cinema photography, and then they become very wealthy, and then suddenly the way they're treated by nonprofits looking for their money is really eye-opening. If anybody's in the fundraising world, I recommend it. But she's the same person the day before and the day after the company floated. So I just think, again, it's just quite obviously, you know, it's an interesting hypothesis that the rich are bad people, but it has to be tested and proven. We can't just state it as if it's proven. And it's not just that they make stupid decisions, that they are more egotistical and so on. You know, we're all just people. But yeah, people giving smaller amounts of money don't tend to get caught in this net. I mean, if I put a pound in a collection box, I get given a sticker to wear, so I can walk around saying, look what I supported. You know, it's the same kind of act as any other donor benefit. I support my local theatre because it means I can start booking tickets 5 days before everyone else and get the seats that I want. You know, mixed motives, but I still get counted as a donor to the theatre. So the more we can break down this idea that rich people act in one way and other donors act in another way. And I've also done studies of non-wealthy donors. And what you find is they're pretty similar. We're all motivated by personal interest, by experiences that hit us, by a desire to have an impact, to live a good life. Just some people have more resources to put behind that than others. But the way we talk about these donors assumes that they're very different. So yeah, I agree with you, Ruth.
Thank you. Another question I received from Keenan Wheeler is, wouldn't it be better to just increase the taxes and let nonprofit do the work and deliver. And so you basically cut the middle person and just let taxes do what taxes do and nonprofit implement the work. What will be your reply to that question?
So, yeah, I mean, this is the tax good, philanthropy bad argument. And look, I am absolutely in favor of a generous tax system. I mean, tax is the price you pay to live in a civilized society. And in Europe, you know, we on the whole have followed that view and do tax higher and have more generous services. I wish there were more so. But there's plenty of work that involves changing things. And that's the point about, you know, undemocratic interventions improving society. So I'll give you an example that I picked up from somebody else's book, Joan Marie Johnson's book on funding feminism. And it's quite a nice historical example about Mary Garrett, who was asked to support the John Hopkins University, which was setting up. So John Hopkins left a legacy to fund the university and the medical school. But because investments didn't pan out as well as they should have done, there's only enough money for the university. So they were left with a gap to make up for the medical school. Now, Mary Garrett said, I will fund the medical school, but only if you admit female students, medical students, on the same grounds, with the same facilities and the same opportunities as male students. And they didn't want to do that. There's, you know, there's evidence to show that they tried to find other donors who would not coerce them. You know, this is philanthropy's power. This is using coercing organizations to do things. But in the end, that was the only donations on the table. So they did it. And you know, I think we would all agree, looking back, that was a helpful use of money as power. The same with state. You know, very often philanthropic effort is trying to get the state to do something differently or better, or to change how it works. And government will not pay to lobby itself. So I think there's always going to be a role. There's an absolutely profound and important role for government action, but there's also a role for philanthropic action if you think that life is improvable and things can be changed. You know, donors I've interviewed talk about the icing on the cake. You know, they don't want to provide the basic services, but they want to put clowns into the kids' hospital. They want to provide extra facilities for the, you know, the school playground. They want to do extra things that make life better. There's always more you can do. So the idea that you could ever fund it only through the state. If I was in a very sad situation and needed to phone a bereavement helpline or something, would I rather speak to a civil servant, or would I rather speak to somebody who was personally affected by that experience and could speak from personal experience? So there is a role for voluntary action that can't be replicated, I think, by the state. So I understand the question, but I think it's to misunderstand the unique role that both government and philanthropy have.
I think in the book you make this argument where we can't think of them as separated, because philanthropists just don't fund thin air. They fund organizations, and this is a system that works together. I have an interesting question in the chat. Recently, we have seen the rise of critiques about who the donors are, and they're mostly white male, older, skewing older. And so do you think the recent critiques could inhibit some of the giving from that demographic who feel particularly targeted recently?
Yeah, I mean, it's a very difficult one to argue or to prove, because obviously it's a counterfactual. If we were all nicer about philanthropy, would there be more giving? You know, there isn't that counterfactual scenario, but I can only point to everything we know about behavioral economics and nudging and how you encourage, you know, good behavior or encourage any set of behavior, and so you don't get there by scorning and derision and scolding. You get there by encouragement. So I think it would seem unlikely if philanthropy was the only thing that worked differently. But the honest truth is, I'm not so worried about the current donors. Certainly nobody I've met and interviewed who's already a very active philanthropist is planning to stop. They're not going to say, I'm so fed up, you know, my skin's so thin, I'm not going to. That's not the case. But they are worried about their children and the people coming after them, saying, you know, they've seen the grief that their parents have had. They've seen the, you know, the stress it's caused. And you just wonder why, if you came into money now, you would think, not just because of the aggro you might get, but if you're being told, actually, you're making the world worse, you're preventing systemic change, you know, you're part of the problem, you're causing more harm than good. Well, even the most well-intentioned person is going to think twice about going, you know, moving into philanthropy. And it also seems a bit complex. It all seems, just so messy that perhaps better just to sit back and wait for a while and see how this all sort of settles out. And that's what I worry about more. So I don't see people who are already giving, because they know what they're doing and they know the good it provides, and they know it's enriching for their life. It's people who are not yet giving. And I think we're really in danger of making philanthropy a very unattractive proposition. And I had a period of my life when I was in politics, actually, in between being a professional a practitioner. I stood for Parliament for the Labour Party, which is why I know for sure that that people on the left can be, you know, can also be pro-philanthropy. And it was a period of time when, if you were in politics, people just assumed you were self-interested and idiot, da, da, da. And actually the quality of people wanting to go into politics is affected by that, because of this public sense of all politicians are idiots. And I just see the same thing happening in philanthropy. And I suppose I want to try and help stop that.
So I have many more questions and we have time. And so I would ask that, yeah, you might reach out directly to Beth if you have more questions. Beth, thank you so much for offering really this interesting critique and engaging with us again about your work. And I wanted to tell everyone in the audience, we have another Philanthro Think coming up. And this week is a perfect start to launch Before Giving Tuesday, that is tomorrow. So thank you so much again. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you for asking me. Good luck to everybody.
Thank you very much.